The play we are about to enjoy tonight, Trying, is based upon the life of Francis Biddle. Francis Biddle was born May 9, 1886, and died October 4, 1868. He earned degrees from Harvard University in 1909 and a law degree at Harvard in 1911. His first work as a private secretary to Supreme Court Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes, Jr. He spent 27 years practicing law in Philadelphia. In 1935, President Roosevelt nominated him to be chairman of the National Labor Relations Board. In 1939, he became a judge on the United States Court of Appeals for the Third Circuit. He also served here for 1 year, leaving to become the United States Solicitor General following Robert Jackson. He was also there in a short-lived position as Roosevelt nominated him to the position of Attorney General, again following Robert H. Jackson. He served in this position throughout most of World War II. At President Truman's request, he resigned after Roosevelt's death. Shortly thereafter, Truman appointed Biddle as the chief American judge at the International Military Tribunal at Nuremberg, where once again his paths crossed with Justice Robert H. Jackson. The play, Trying, authored by Joanna McClellan Glass, is designed to deal with the latter part of the life of Francis Biddle. Joanna McClellan Glass served as Biddle's personal secretary from 1967 through 1968. Most important for the Robert Jackson Center is Francis Biddle's interrelationship at the Nuremberg trial.
Und hinter uns kommt Deutschland!
The French judges, Falco and Defavre, enter first, followed by the Americans, Parker and Biddle, and the Britishers, Lawrence and Burkett. The Russian judges, Nikitchenko and Volchkov, prefer their uniforms to the judicial robe. Each of the four nations provides one member of the court and one alternate. The American delegate, Francis Biddle, ex-Attorney General of the United States, sits next to Lord Justice Lawrence.
I couldn't face going back into private practice. Not after all those years in Washington. The nerve center of the country, the war. What is the current status in Nuremberg?
Oh, we're gathering evidence, choosing defendants. We've settled on 22 men. We've narrowed our targets to those who ran the concentration camps.
Good thinking, splendid.
Ones who gathered the slave labor as well as those that used it?
Absolutely right.
The judges will have a great deal of work ahead of them with the pretrial discovery.
Yes. Well, of course, you'll be there to guide me through it. I'm thrilled, Bob. It's an honor. This means a great deal to me. Am I safe in calling the president and telling him that you've signed off on me? That I'm approved as chief American judge? I'll arrange your flight this week. We need you over there as quickly as possible. We need to gear up fast. The trial's in 1 month. We'll have dessert in Nuremberg.
It's just arrived from Biddle. He's decided not to fly. He's coming over on the Queen Elizabeth. He'll be here in 3 weeks.
I'm a bit surprised at Biddle. I'd never seen a man so hungry for approval.
Well, yeah, but then you approved him, Bob.
I did learn a lesson there, didn't I? And how I hate learning lessons. Francis, I had arranged for a flight to pick you up. You were meant to.
What happened? You developed a sudden craving for shuffleboard?
I just needed a little time to get myself up to speed. I worked the whole way over. I'm fully prepared now. It was a gift from my family. After the trial, I'm going to donate this along with my papers to my alma mater. I think future generations...
Francis, will... on the subject of who will serve as president of the court, the British are prepared to support you, but,
Yes?
But it's not in the best interest of the trial. The Americans are far too dominant in this thing already. The trial must be viewed as a joint effort.
I really do have the qualifications.
I know you do.
If not me, then who?
Sir Geoffrey Lawrence. The British share our sensibilities, and it's a hell of a lot better than having Duvall or God knows Nikitchenko. I think I can sell the French on this idea, too.
Everyone back home assumes that I will be head of the court.
Francis, your role here will be of incredible importance.
This is probably the last appointment of my career, Bob. This is how I'm going out with great honor.
Francis, you will be capping your career.
Sir Geoffrey, with my respects.
Bless you, Biddle.
After you.
All right!
Some kind of treason against the new state were naturally turned over to the courts. The others, whom one might expect such acts, but who had not yet committed them, such as the functionaries of the Communist Party, who were attacking us in the thousands...
You've answered the question, thank you.
I need to explain further.
Well, you'll have the opportunity to explain further under re-examination from your own counsel. Now, did you prohibit all court review of the cause for taking people into what you were calling at the time protective custody?
That I answered very clearly, but I should like to make an explanation in connection with my answer.
The counsel will see to that. Now, about the concentration camps.
Mr. Justice Jex, the tribunal thinks the witness ought to be allowed to make what explanation he thinks right in answer to this question.
The tribunal thinks that you should be permitted to explain your answer now, and it will listen to that explanation.
Officer, a soldier, I serve my country.
Now I ask
thirdly,
you this,
Your Honor, please. Thirdly, I was not the man to forsake someone to whom I had given my oath of loyalty every time he was not to my way of thinking.
Your Honor.
It never, ever occurred to me to leave the Fuhrer.
Your Honor, the witness is adopting a contemptuous attitude toward this tribunal, which is giving him the trial that he never gave a living soul nor dead ones either.
Objection, Your Honor.
I'm ready for the next question.
Yes, Bob.
You know, Judge, I didn't leave the Supreme Court to come here and be thwarted by a fellow countryman.
That sounds like sour grapes. Very unbecoming.
To an outsider, it might appear like you were deliberately trying to sabotage me.
Bob.
You gave Gehring an open forum during direct examination. I must be able to control him during cross.
Listen, Bob. Just accept the fact that you weren't at the top of your game today. You have the weekend to prepare for the next round. Make good use of it.
The whole process took perhaps about a month, during which, when the judges were in their chambers, they were going over the guilt or innocence of these people. And they did a very conscientious job.
On October 1st, 1946, after 315 days of trial, the sentences were pronounced.
When Yale was still a pup. What's your husband's name?
Paul. He came to D.C. to work for,
Sarah, with an H. You might well know that I have very little interest in the husbands. Over the years, I've been obliged to listen to a surfeit of secretarial matrimonial sagas, and I no longer have the resources for it. Were you at Smith?
No, sir.
Radcliffe? Wellesley?
No, sir. I'm not one of those.
One of those what?
One of the pleated plaid Ivy girls.
Oh. Catherine told me that, but I'd forgotten. I'm sorry I wasn't able to interview you personally. I was bedridden that day.
Oh, yes, Mrs. Biddle explained that you were ill.
I'm always ill. I'm ill unrelievedly. I've got a list of ailments from here to Mount Rushmore. Occasionally, I'm ill horizontally, but mostly, I'm ill vertically. Catherine liked you very much.
Oh, thank you. I sensed that at the interview, but I was quite surprised when she phoned last week.
Why? Were you? Why?
Well, she had implied, very politely, of course, that I might be too young. She said that generally, you prefer an older, more matronly women.
That has been my preference. Because where I am is where they'll soon be. So one could hope for empathy. I tried to hire retired civil servants. The last one, however, was an unmitigated disaster. Stupid in the extreme, I had to let her go. Whereupon Catherine persuaded me to make an exception. Find someone young, she said. Young and pliable. Your previous employment was with an advertising agency.
Yes, sir.
What did you do there?
I was a copywriter.
You mean that awful blather is actually composed by somebody?
Well, yes, sir. I hope at some time in the future to write more seriously.
Do you know what's wrong with Winston tastes good like a cigarette should?
Oh, yes, sir. It should be as a cigarette should.
Indeed it should. Our language is deteriorating at the speed of light. May I ask why you didn't apply to an ad agency in D.C.?
Well, now that my husband's finished school, I can take a part-time job, and this position would be very interesting.
I see. This snow, 2 weeks before Thanksgiving, is most unusual. To my amazement, Pierre got out early and shoveled a path across the yard. Did you meet the house staff?
Oh, yes, I came through the kitchen on my way over.
Oh, they're a man and wife team, French. They came to us via William Bullitt. Bill Bullitt was the first American ambassador to the Soviet Union. Monique Cooks, Pierre Buttles, and his man Friday.
Monique asked me to bring the thermos tray.
Where did you put it?
Over there, on the file cabinet.
No. We put the tray... The tray and the mail have to be lugged by the secretary. It's difficult for me to climb the stairs and carry things. I've got a metal pin in my ankle. Did you bring the mail?
Yes, I did.
It's idiotic at my age, keeping my office over the garage, especially since I have to limp across the yard to get here, but houses tend to be seats of domesticity. I learned very early on that cerebral efforts haven't a hope in hell in the midst of the women and the ladies. Although I guess that distinction, the women and the ladies, is outmoded now. Obviously, you're cold.
Oh, yes, a little.
You're cold because you came early, and not when you were told to come. You probably wanted to make a good impression on your first day. You'll find if you stay that I'm far more impressed by adherence to rules.
I'm sorry, I did want to...
The place is heated by these hideous gas heaters. The operation of them is... And this is very important. The operation of them must be left entirely to me. We will work mornings only 9 until noon. If I arrive at 8:30 and you arrive at 9, I'll have the heaters up and running. And I suppose I must add, since employers are obliged to set terms, that if you arrive at 9:15, you'll be tardy and I'll be irritable. Now, these damn heaters are as ancient as I am. The imbecile who designed them put the dials down at the floor. I should get something with a wall dial, but I will go to the expense because I don't expect to last much longer. In fact, I'm fairly certain this is my final year. That's the bathroom over there. If you're like all the others, you'll go in there to cry.
Oh, well, perhaps I will.
The odds are against it.
Please, Judge Middle, may I help you?
You may not. You must never, ever touch the heaters. Not at 9, not at noon, never. 5 years ago, the secretary thought she'd turned them off when she left. But in fact, she turned them up to high, and she set the place on fire. There. It'll warm up soon. Catherine sang your praises most insistently.
Oh, thank you. How is Mrs. Biddle's arthritis today?
She's got the heating pad on it. Did she interview you in the study?
Oh, no, we had tea in the living room. The house is very old, isn't it?
Not for Georgetown, 1830. This building used to be a stable. And this, of course, was the hayloft.
I was absolutely stunned at your Cezanne. I mean, to walk into a private home and see a Cezanne just hanging there.
It's been in the family for years. My branch of the Biddles, Philadelphia Biddles, were avid collectors. I gather that since you know your Cezanne from your Gauguin, you appreciate art.
Oh, yes, I do.
And literature?
Poetry, mostly.
Really?
Yes, I read voraciously.
That usage of the adverb is a thorn in my side. Webster disagrees with me, but I'm old enough to say to hell with Webster. I prefer that one eats voraciously, but reads voluminously. Reads volumes extensively. Please don't employ that usage again.
No, sir, I won't.
It's a thorn in my side. Did Catherine tell you that she's a published poet?
No, sir.
Well, she's modest. I would have had a very narrow, very restricted legal life had it not been for Catherine and her artistic friends. I suppose she told you I'm difficult.
Oh, no, sir. Not exactly.
Well, did she say the job would require a certain fortitude?
Not exactly.
Oh, come now. She must have at least implied that your sojourn here would not be a bed of roses.
Well, actually, yes. She implied words to that effect.
Of course she did. I know her. What did she say was the primary prerequisite for the job?
She said, spine.
Oh, spine. Well, she hired you, so I will deduce that you have that.
Yes, sir. I think I can summon it when I need it.
We shall see. Now, where were we? Oh, yes, the heaters. You see, she swore she'd turned them off, but in fact, she left them up on high, up in ashes. Historically significant papers from my years as AG. Attorney General, I was AG under Roosevelt, 1941 to 1945. My maternal great-great-grandfather was the first Attorney General, Edmund Randolph of Virginia, appointed by George Washington. This is not good. The thermos tray is not on the coffee table. For some mysterious reason, the thermos tray is on the filing cabinet.
Well, sir,
it doesn't belong on the filing cabinet. It belongs on the table with the sugar bowl. I told you that a minute ago.
No, sir, you didn't.
I'm certain I did.
Perhaps you intended to.
If I didn't, your powers of observation should have informed you how absolutely perverse to see a sugar bowl and then set the thermos on the filing cabinet. Forgive me for observing that your powers of observation leave a great deal to be desired.
I'm sorry.
Intestines are at war with me. Up in ashes. My entire collection of Daumier lithographs. No one caricatured the legal profession quite like Daumier. And two of my private journals from the Nuremberg trials. I was chief American judge of the International Military Tribunal at Nuremberg in 1946. Appointed, of course, by Truman. You'll see that much of what was left is scorched. Oftentimes when I refer to an old book, I can still smell the smoke. And hear the sirens.
Judge Biddle, Mrs. Biddle said you would outline my duties.
I'd like a cup of coffee, please. Unless, of course, you consider this task altogether too menial in this year of our Lord, 1967. What with Betty Friedan and half of you out there burning your upper underwear.
Oh, I'm happy to get it.
Well, I'm sure you're not happy, but we'll deal with that when it surfaces, if you stay.
Sir, it's my intention to stay. Why would I not?
I will be 82 next year. You'll find that I'm old and ailing and cranky. You will find that I function, when I function at all, somewhere between lucidity and senility. I'm set in my ways. And Catherine insists that I'm guilty of the regrettable habit of always having to have the last word. Did you tell me your age?
25.
Two lumps of sugar, please. And help yourself. I was 56 when you were born. If I were you, I wouldn't be quite so confident of your staying powers. We can't help but find each other extremely trying.
I made a promise. I promised Mrs. Biddle that I'd try.
Try?
Yes.
Well, isn't that admirable? God knows I need help. Look at this desk. Paper chaos, it's absolutely crushing.
Should I set this here?
No, over there. Thank you.
You're welcome. Sir, Mrs. Biddle said that you'd outline my duties.
It would seem quite unaccountably that the mail has pissadeered. Where is the mail?
I put it over here on the secretary's desk.
Well, that is not good, really. Your placement of things is decidedly irregular. Explain to me why my mail is on the secretary's desk.
I assume that you'd want me to open it.
Oh, I don't. Do you see this letter opener? Henry James visited Philadelphia and gave this ivory letter opener to my mother in 1905. It has not become, as I have, obsolete. Fetch my mail, please, from the secretary's desk. Oh, may I deduce from your movement that you heard me? Yes, the wind. Respond. You moderns are bereft of all social grace. I call you feeble moderns. Or is it feckless moderns? No matter, both apply. This is from Jacob Perlman, historian at Princeton. Let's see. Professor Perlman wants to know if Felix Frankfurter suggested me to for Solicitor General. I was Solicitor General before I was Attorney General. The short answer is yes. This is from a publisher in New York who is waiting for my memoirs. He dares to remind me that he has a contract, that I am several chapters in arrears. You type, of course.
Yes, sir.
And you have shorthand.
Yes, sir.
Greg, hopefully.
No, it's called speed writing.
Speed writing? Does that mean something, or is it just modern babble? Does it mean that you write English speedily as I speak it?
Yes, it's a combination of symbols and letters.
Alphabetical letters?
Yes, and symbols.
Show me. Go fetch a pad. I don't understand why, if you're going to go to the bother of learning chicken scratch, why you don't learn the time-honored Greg. You ready? Take this down, please. When the elite meet to eat, the talk is refined. Let me see it. Well, isn't that peculiar?
It's what's being taught nowadays.
And therefore you consider it better?
Not necessarily.
What was her name?
Who, sir?
The one who had Pittman rather than Greg.
I don't know, sir.
It was a flower name, help me.
Rose.
No.
Iris.
No. Mormon girl. The Mormons like the flowery names.
Lily?
Marigold! She learned Pittman instead of Greg. Marigold the Mormon.
Sir, perhaps now would be a good time to outline my duties.
God almighty, you sound like a broken record. Do you think I find these initiation mornings easy? It's all very easy for you. 25, breezing in here, both eager and early. But can you imagine how stressful the hiring process is for an old man? Calling employment agencies, interviewing, getting references, having to trot out a welcome wagon full of appropriate noises for the 1,000th time?
Sir, Mrs. Biddle explained that this morning would be stressful for you. I didn't arrive expecting appropriate noises, but I would very much appreciate some instruction as to my duties.
Madam, you are nothing if not single-minded. Yes? Catherine, if you know I can't talk, why are you calling? How do you think it's going? It's going very badly. No, I'm not behaving myself. It'll be a miracle, an absolute 4-star fish and loaves miracle if she stays. I am quite undone! I've got floaters in my vision. Your nagging has quite undone me. I need to stretch out. I have to lie down on the easy chair. You'll see over there on your desk a pile of bills. The household checkbook hasn't been reconciled in months. Apparently I paid last month's phone bill 3 times. And I didn't pay the light bill at all. And I'm receiving rude letters from the water company. Go and reconcile the checkbook.
Yes, sir. Judge Biddle?
Your duties will include many a foray to the post office. A large percentage of the population is writing books about Franklin Delano Roosevelt. They write voluminously, and then they pack it off to me for verification. It's bad enough that I have to read it, and it's worse that I have to muck about with returning it. May I assume that if you don't find pouring coffee too menial, you won't mind running errands?
Oh, no, sir, I won't mind.
If I fall asleep and noon creeps around, leave quietly, and do not touch the heaters.
Yes, sir.
Take the thermos tray and the mails back to the house.
Yes, sir. Sir, do you have the canceled checks?
Did you hear me? I said, do not touch the heaters.
I have not touched the heaters.
9:00, not noon, never. She knew very well that all the way right was all the way on, and all the way left was all the way off. Dwight, George. Simple enough, but she couldn't get through her thick skull. That is not why I'm calling. I do not always have to have the last word. Though, here she comes. We'll have to discuss it later.
Good morning.
Good morning. Precisely 9 a.m., and that is good.
Thank you.
I have the heat up and running.
Yes, I can feel it.
I'm sorry I conked out on you yesterday. First days with a new one are rather like a dreaded exam.
Yes, sir, I understand. Here is your mail, and Monique asked me to give you this note.
We don't call Monique Monique.
Really?
We call Monique Cook. Yes, that is our habit. I've had a terrific tune-up with my wife this morning, and it's left me unraveled. Or has she reported that to you already, since you're such pals?
No, sir.
Are you sure? Not conspiratorially in the back hall?
Sir, I haven't seen Mrs. Biddle this morning.
She was downright surly at breakfast. She said she knew instinctively after only one day that I wasn't trying to make our association work. And I took umbrage. I resent the implication that something, anything, is expected of me in my final year. It's inconceivable to me that these truths are not self-evident. I'm in the process of leaving this life. The exit sign is flashing over the door. The door is ajar. You would think a spouse of 50 years would know that. God, I hate tune-ups. They hang over the day like a shroud, and then they hover over dinner and sully every mouthful. Oh, by the way, I forgot to tell you. That's the bathroom over there.
Oh, yes. Thank you. May I get you a cup of coffee?
When I want it, I'll ask for it. Come, sit down. Did you reconcile the checkbook?
I'm afraid that's going to take more time.
Huh?
You see, it's not just a case of paying the same bill three times. It's a case of... Well, sir, unfortunately, it's a case of paying the same bill three times with differing amounts, and then deducting the differing amounts three times. That's why when the statement arrives, you have much, much more in the bank than you do in the checkbook.
Madam, you are bold. are not discreet.
I was just trying to illustrate the extent of the problem.
Once upon a time, I had a mind like a steel trap. Can you fix it?
Yes, sir, I can in time.
Look at this in basket. Overflowing. And this letter from the publisher is dated mid-September. And here we are with Thanksgiving right around the corner. I just can't face it. I may have to lie down.
Judge Farrell, please, don't despair. Let's make a stab at it.
I can't. It's the tuna at breakfast.
Please, sir, try and rally.
I can't rally. But I suppose I have to try. Before I do, perhaps you could tell me, where are you from in Canada?
Saskatchewan.
Come, show me. It's that big rectangle in the middle, isn't it?
Yes, it's one of the western provinces. There, yeah? Saskatoon, Saskatchewan.
Oh, dear me, it's far away from everything.
Yes.
I mean, it's not even near Chicago. 10 provinces.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And you have premiers rather than governors.
Yes. Our most famous one in Saskatchewan is Tommy Douglas. He's the man who pioneered Canada's universal health plan.
Oh, really? Tell me about Tommy Douglas.
Sir, why don't we write to the publisher and apologize for the delay and tell him that you're back on track?
I don't feel like it.
I can tell that you don't, but sir, we are going to be absolutely defeated by this paperwork unless we lace the skates and hit the ice.
That's what all good Canadians would do.
Yes, sir. All good Canadians worth their salt.
Very well. Oh, what should I know about Saskatoon, Saskatchewan?
Well, it's prairie, wheat country. The provincial university is in Saskatoon, and the city was incorporated in 1906.
Oh, 1906. Goodness me. I was 20 years old in 1906. And tell me this. What sort of people wanted to settle in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan?
The first settlers were a temperance colony. They were fleeing what they thought to be very liberal liquor laws in the east.
Ah, and where did your people come from?
Scotland, originally.
Presbyterian?
Yes, well, I should say lukewarm Presbyterian.
Mine came from England. My first American ancestor, William Biddle, had been imprisoned as a dissenting Quaker, as had William Penn before him.
Oh, may I have the name of your publisher?
Alfred Knopf. This is very interesting. In 1681, William Biddle came across the pond and purchased from William Penn 43,000 acres of what is now New Jersey. Shortly after that, the Biddles descended on Philadelphia.
Do you have Knopf's address?
No. Yeah. Here is Knopf's address. Knopf's address is 201 East 55th. I think I should tell Alfred Knopf that I have a new secretary. Mrs. Sarah with an H, Shore, is late of Saskatchewan. Mrs. Shore has an overbearing Scots Presbyterian manner. If you're going to cry, go in there.
I'm not going to cry. If and when you make me cry, I will sit right here in this chair and cry.
And make me bear witness?
Yes, sir. Sir, my father was a bully. I vowed when I left Saskatoon that I'd never allow another person to bully me. Please, do not ask me for personal information and then make snide remarks.
I didn't do that.
Yes, you did. Late of Saskatchewan, overbearing Scots Presbyterian.
You see, this tune-up this morning was a humdinger. Catherine is a well-balanced woman, normally, but on these occasions when she's surly, I tell you, the flies leave the room.
Sir, we have a couple of possible solutions. If you will dictate as long as you can, I'll happily stay overtime if necessary and type the letters.
You can stay until doomsday, but the heat goes off at noon, after when I leave.
Very well. I don't mind taking the dictation home and typing the letters there. and you will see that by Christmas we will keep that basket empty.
I must say, you're inordinately anxious to work.
Well, yes, sir. While I was growing up, I was paid what is just about the best compliment you can get on the prairie. People said I was a bugger for work.
All right. Take this down, please. Speedily. Dear Sam, I'm sorry to bore you with staff problems. Indeed, I know it's unseemly to do so, but I've been having one devil of a time with secretaries. In June, I had to fire a woman who was stupid in the extreme, and then, of course, we left for Cape Cod. When we returned, the September woman was an unmitigated disaster. Now, however, I've hired a young girl who is, in her own words, a bugger for work. She will make sure that you receive the chapter about my ancestors before Christmas. Thank you for your patience. Sincerely, Francis. Type that up, please.
Yes, sir.
Why did your father bully you?
Well, he was an alcoholic. He'd been fired from a rather prestigious position, and it seems that with the loss of the job, he lost his identity.
Not unusual. Equating oneself with one's title is a particularly male affliction.
Yes, he just, you know, locked himself in the house and drank. He actually bartered away the contents of our house for whiskey.
What do you mean, contents?
Winchester rifles, golf clubs, silverware. I started working part-time when I was 11.
Must have been very difficult.
Yes, it was. Oh, my mother? She had to...
Please, Sarah. On my knees, Sarah. Don't tell me more. I'm sorry, but I no longer have the resources. Surely you're not this candid with everyone.
No, but I don't lie about it. It's who I am.
You will find, as you go along, that you'll need one or two masks in your survival kit.
Do you think so?
I know so. It's the way the world functions. Now, I have to call Nielsen at the Pentagon. He called 2 weeks ago, but I've been too unraveled to return his call.
Would you like me to place it?
Oh, I would not. I've never approved of those gents who bellow, get me Wolfson at the interior, get me Robinson at state. I'm perfectly capable of making these calls myself. It is not, however, a pleasant procedure because my hands don't work, so I ask you please not to watch me. Did you hear me?
Yes.
Well, then, for God's sake, respond.
I will not watch you.
Thank you. Nielsen at the Pentagon. Oh, yes. You're watching me.
I'm not.
Hello. May I speak with? I'd like to speak with. Just a moment. Who?
Nielsen.
Nielsen. Kenneth Nielsen, please. But it's 10 o'clock in the morning. Where could he be? Boston? Yeah. All right. Judge Biddle. Decatur, 24858. But he mustn't call in the afternoon. I can only work from 9 till noon. Yes. I'll be 82 next year. Thank you. That was one of my lapses. When I have them, I find myself floundering out there in an ether. It's as if my mind excuses itself without asking my permission. It just saunters off and thumbs its nose at me. It pissadeers. Strange thing is, a split second after the lapse, I can tell you that Kenneth Nielsen's middle name is Maxwell. His wife's name is Marjorie. And they live at 1544 Halifax Street. I'm going to come round and sit for a moment. This chair allows my arms to dangle, and it relieves the pain in my hands. Did you see the Post this morning?
No, I didn't.
Jacqueline Kennedy and Aristotle and Onassis are an item.
I don't believe it.
Catherine always said, we knew the Bouvier girls like money, we just never knew how much. Didn't you tell me that you read poetry voluminously?
Oh, yes, I did.
Who are your favorite poets?
Edna St. Vincent Millay and E.E. Cummings.
Ah, really? Odd juxtaposition. Cummings was at Harvard, you know. Class of 1915.
Yes. Oh, I heard on the radio this morning that Lyndon Johnson's got 10,000 protesters in front of the White House today. Cummings had plenty to say on that subject.
What subject?
Civil disobedience.
What, for instance?
Well, one pungent line in particular comes to mind, but I'm afraid I can't repeat it.
Oh, repeat it, please.
I can't, sir. It contains an obscenity.
Oh, bosh and bunkum, tell me.
Are you sure?
Positive.
I will not kiss your F-U-C-K-I-N-G flag.
I'd forgotten that. It's from I Sing of Olaf Glad and Big, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
I think this too is from Olaf. There is some S-H-I-T I will not eat.
Yes, sir.
Do you know spring when the world is mud-luscious and puddle-wonderful?
Yes, I do.
Do you know this world is all a leak and life preservers? There are none.
No, sir. Was it Cummings?
Yes. Catherine and I had two sons. We still have one. The other died at 7.
I'm very sorry. What was his name?
Garrison Chapin Biddle. 40 years ago. Penicillin would have saved him, but it wasn't available then. Life preservers, there were none. Did they give you any Shakespeare up there in Saskatoon?
Yes, 2 plays a year for 4 years.
Oh, I don't imagine you studied King John.
No, sir.
No, they only teach you the crowd pleasers. Oh, by the way, I forgot to tell you, that's the bathroom.
Yes.
He says in King John, grief fills the room up of my absent child, lies in his bed, walks up and down with me, puts on his pretty looks, repeats his words, remembers me of all his gracious parts, stuffs out his vacant garments with his form. Then have I reason to be fond of grief. Who would have thought so much pain could be condensed in finger joints?
Oh, sir, my grandmother's hands were crippled with arthritis. The doctor told her to immerse them in oatmeal baths, but it didn't help. The only thing that helped was massaging her knuckles with Bengay.
I've got a tube of it in my desk drawer, but to make a bad pun of it, and here's the rub, how in hell can I massage the knuckles when it hurts to use my hands?
Oh, I can do it for you.
I beg your pardon.
I just thought...
Madam, you are as bold as brass.
I didn't mean to...
I've never, ever heard such a forward, ultimately embarrassing suggestion.
I didn't mean to offend.
Well, you did, and it must never happen again. Do you hear me?
Yes, sir, I'm sorry.
And what the hell does Cook want?
A check.
A check? What for? I paid them on the first of the month, didn't I?
Yes, you did.
And she must think that I am Aristotle Onassis. I have never in my 55 years of hiring servants had to pay for their shoe leather. She says that the shoes they wear are worn performing household services, and therefore it is only just, mind you, that I give her $100 to keep them shod.
Sir, really, try
not to... Don't nag at me! Didn't you do that? Did you do that to your grandmother? Did you nag her to death? I'm going to call Bill Bullitt. Bullitt was ambassador to France after Moscow. He hired them in Paris and brought them over when he came back. I tell you, if William Bullitt says he bought their shoes, I will rise like a phoenix and go right through the sea ceiling. Bullitt. Bullitt. There's a line through it.
Is he unlisted, or would he be in the book?
He's in the cemetery. He died last February. Catherine and I went to the service. Do you see this? You see all these lines? All the bees are dead. Can you believe it? Surely they can't be. But they are. All the bees are dead.
I'm sorry. Sir, what are you doing?
I'm shutting off the heat. I'm calling it a day.
Please, sir, don't. Let's discuss Cook's request.
The woman is a succubus. I already provide them with wine at lunch and dinner. They say it's their Gallic birthright. They say that without it, they'll develop ulcers. Get your coat. We're finished here.
Sir, we really do need to answer Professor Perlman's inquiry about Justice Frankfurter.
What is that? The royal we. You may need to, but I have no such need. These historians push and poke and prod and then get it all wrong anyway. Oh, what the hell. I suppose for accuracy I should answer. Get your book.
He wanted to know...
I remember what he wanted to know. Take this down, and I leave it to you to plug in the niceties. Yes, in 1940, Felix Frankfurter recommended to President Roosevelt that I be appointed Solicitor General. A year later, I was, of course, appointed Attorney General.
Sir, you're going too fast.
It wouldn't be if you'd learned Greg. We had known each other long before our Washington days because of our mutual connection to Harvard Law. I had graduated in 1911, and Felix became a professor there as early as 1914. I hope you find this information adequate, sincerely, etc., etc. We have now answered the inquiry. Go and get your coat. And when you go through the kitchen, I want you to muster every bit of Canadian civility that you possess and tell the succubus to take up the shoe matter with Mrs. Biddle.
Sir, she said she did that back in October, and Mrs. Biddle assured her that you'd given her a check.
What? Are you telling me that Catherine agreed to keeping them shod?
Yes, sir.
God almighty! You know what that means? It means another damned tune-up at dinner time. Oh, it is absolutely crushing. If you're ready to go, go.
May I take the letters at home?
Are you going to charge me overtime?
No, sir.
Very well, take your book. And take the thermos tray.
Yes, sir. Oh, sir, may I help?
Do not touch me. I may be an invalid, but I'm not yet entirely invalid.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Sarah!
Yes, sir?
I am not your Morning.
How are you today?
Not good. I've got the sinus drip. The doctor says it will pass. As will life, I told him. Gene McCarthy's announced his candidacy.
Do you think Bobby Kennedy will?
I don't know. Maybe. How was your Thanksgiving?
Oh, it was all right. We had to go up to Yale again. My husband had a meeting about his dissertation.
You're upset.
I'm sorry.
Because you were deprived of a turkey dinner?
No, sir. Because the trip was difficult. Just the two of us in the car for all those hours.
Please, don't burden me with it.
No, sir.
I have very little strength, and what I have is precious. And I'm still wading through this tome about the Japanese internment. Is this the work you did at home?
Yes, sir. Three letters that need your signature.
Three?
Yes, sir. One was to Mr. Nielsen of the Pentagon, one to Dylan Ripley at the Smithsonian, and one to Ruth Stern.
Why did I write Ruth Stern?
She inquired about the time you spent as secretary to Oliver Wendell Holmes.
Justice Holmes, to you, madam?
Yes, sir, Justice Holmes.
I don't understand why you have to do so much work at home.
I can't seem to manage to get it done here.
Well, let's hope that your recognition of the problem leads to improvement.
Yes, sir. Sir, we're making good headway on the memoirs. May we continue?
Are you deaf? I said that I'm critiquing this manuscript about the Japanese internment.
Sir, wouldn't it be more productive if we reserved the time that I'm here for dictation?
I intuit that you are in your persistent mode. God knows hell hath no fury like Sarah in her persistent mode. Bring your book.
Thank you. How was your Thanksgiving?
Not good. One of my nephews brought bad news about a great nephew. I'm going to have to write my lawyer and change my will. Ready?
Yes, sir.
My father died when I was 6 years old, leaving my 32-year-old mother with four boys. Oh.
Sir, what is it?
Blocked. Intestines.
Oh, well, sir, chamomile can always...
Please don't tell me your granny's remedy.
Is there anything I can do?
You can take this down. Oh. In 1899, when I was 13, I was sent to board at Groton, north of Boston. I remained there for 6 years until 1905. In 1905, we still used horses and buggies, and Mark Twain was still alive. Leo Tolstoy was still alive. New paragraph. Franklin Roosevelt had been at Groton before me. I was a new boy when Franklin was a sixth former. He told me in later years that he enjoyed it. I did not enjoy it. I found the place to be bleak and austere, entirely without embellishment. There was not one whit of privacy. I was surrounded by a melee of boys every hour of the day, and yet I was always lonely. I recall being herded at the crack of dawn toward rows of metal sinks that held chunks of harsh yellow soap. After morning wash, we'd put on our little blue suits with the Eton collars and listen to the Reverend Endicott Peabody tell us what American boys lacked was tone. I think I can't continue. Go and type it up.
Endicott has two T's.
Yes. The Reverend Endicott Peabody damn near killed me with his sanctimonious religiosity. He knew and taught and understood one thing only. He called it muscular Christianity. Oh, please, God on my knees, God, let me depart this earth without ever again experiencing muscular Christianity. Well, go type it up.
Before I do, sir, cook stopped me again as I went through the kitchen. She insists on a check for the shoes.
I'm at the end of my tether with that clucking French woman. What do you think I should do?
Do you really want my opinion?
Yes, yes, yes.
I think one has to consider the psychic toll.
The psychic toll?
Yes.
Bosh and buckle.
Sir, if you let this sit there and fester, it will affect your other activities. But if you write the check, you can erase it from your slate and... Really, it's a very minor matter.
It isn't minor, it's a matter of principle. I'm not like Groucho Marx. If you don't like my principles, I have others. Please be seated.
Yes, sir.
This is to Robert Henderson, Esquire. Dear Bob, sorry to say I need another codicil to my will. John was here at Thanksgiving, and he did not bring tidings of great joy about Michael. Michael has gone too far this time. He's using drugs. I want him out immediately. And I want his 10,000 to go to the Memorial Library. This latter, however, I want inter vivos. Please send a letter of confirmation. Thank you. Sincerely, Francis. Type that first. And then the memoirs. No, wait a minute. Take this down before I forget it. I remembered it this morning. It's for later in the memoirs. Hermann Wilhelm Goering wore the double-breasted light gray uniform of a Reich Marshal. It was faded and baggy and without decorations. He sat in the corner of the defendant's box with a rug across his knees. Save that, please, in the Nuremberg folder.
Yes, sir.
What are you doing? What can't you spell?
Inter vivos.
Oh.
I don't know if it's two words and I don't know what it means.
Of course you don't. Your knowledge is, to put it kindly, somewhat circumscribed, due to the influence of Saskatchewan, no doubt.
Judge Biddle, I will not listen to
this. Oh, don't be so belligerently sensitive. I think we can safely say, without insult, that I have forgotten more in the last year than you've learned in all of your 25. If you weren't so damned obtuse, you'd decipher it. Inter vivos, in life. While living, I want the money to pass to the Memorial Library now, before I die. Hello. Of course he's here. You're speaking with him. Yes, I sent 4 checks. Dividend checks. Yes, to be deposited in my personal account. They are. Oh, I must have forgotten them. You see, I'll be 82 next year. Let me tell you what happens. It's as if my mind excuses itself without asking my permission. It saunters off and thumbs its nose at me. Oh, yes, I will. Thank you. I sent a deposit slip to the bank, listing 4 checks. I didn't send the checks. I didn't send them, and I have no idea where they are. Check your book to see if I listed them.
Oh, sir, I have only the household checkbook. You would have logged them into your personal checkbook at the house.
And do you know why my personal checkbook has to be kept at the house?
No, sir.
Because I couldn't trust that imbecile secretary. She blabbed my personal finances all over town. Actually, told the clucking succubus how much IBM I owned. And when I refused to raise her wage, she said, "Sir, if you can contribute $500 to the Mozart Society, surely you can give me a raise." city teens with them, you know. Retired, desiccated civil servants. They spend 30 years in government cubicles, and then they get themselves tight little permanent waves and come to me and set the place on fire! It's too hot in here!
Sir, really, it's quite comfortable.
Oh, don't be so damn contrary. I'll just turn this one down. Look for the checks, girl! Look for the checks!
Mrs. Biddle, it's Sarah.
What the hell are you doing?
I'm sorry to bother you, but we've just had a call from the bank regarding the personal account.
Oh?
Yes, dividend checks. The deposit slip was sent, but the checks weren't. Therefore, could I ask you please to try and locate them? Thank you.
How dare you include Catherine in this fiasco?
Sir, the checks have to be found.
Well, then find them!
I can't find them! I'm not permitted to find them. They're in your office at the house.
What insolence. All I wanted was an obedient, pliable clerk for a period of 1 year. You are not pliable. You are the most trying individual I have ever had the misfortune to know. Really, I don't know what was in Catherine's head. I need a cup of coffee.
Well, may I get that for you?
You may not. And since you came in here today, chomping at the bit for a tune-up, I'll give you one. I cannot, I will not, leave that blanket dismissal of yours unaddressed any longer.
What blanket dismissal?
That pleated, plaid, Ivy Girl dismissal. No, sir, I'm not one of those. It's nothing but sour grapes. Chip on the shoulder, nose out of joint. Blatant sour grapes.
Judge Biddle, I'm a prairie populist. It was hard for me working at the ad agency, watching the Smithies being promoted just because they were Smithies. I believe that one has to zealously take issue with unfair practices.
To zealously take issue is a split infinitive. Historically, we'll not use the damn thing. I'd as soon throw it in the rubbish.
Oh, sir, you can't. It was a Christmas present, and a very expensive one at that.
I don't know what was in Catherine's head.
Well, couldn't we just try?
There you go again with your royal we. No, we cannot. You must remember, Sarah, that at one time I learned to talk on the telephone. That was, shall we say, admissible, because there was a human being at the other end. I cannot and will not make a conversation with a machine.
Oh, but they're so easy to use. All you do is push this button to start the tape, and then you talk into this microphone.
Oh, what the hell's the advantage of it?
Well, you're here a half hour before I am. You could dictate while you're waiting, or when I go to the post office, and then when I return, I'd play it back and transcribe it. I'd wear the earphones so you wouldn't hear anything, and you could concentrate on reading correspondence and manuscripts.
Show me how it works.
Okay. Happy New Year, Mr. Dictaphone. It is January 1968. You have been rescued from the shells of Gins, and now you are free to happily and gainfully reside here in Judge Biddle's office.
Perhaps you actually don't know what a split infinitive is. When you insert an adverb between to and the verb reside, you are splitting the infinitive. So it isn't you are free to happily and gainfully reside. You are free to reside happily and gainfully.
Yes. I'm sorry, I forget sometimes.
It is a thorn in my side.
Yes, I'm sorry. Now, if we want to listen to what I said, we push this to rewind. See?
Mm-hmm.
And then you hear the click, and you can play it back.
Happy New Year, Mr. Dictaphone. It is January 1968. You have been rescued from the shadows of Gins, and now you are free to happily and gainfully reside here in Judge Biddle's office.
You see? Easy as pie. Mm. They're being used very widely now.
Amazing. It's an amazing gadget altogether. How would you remove what you just said?
Well, you'd rewind and then speak over it. Oh. Once you got the hang of it, you might even want to take it to the house and dictate there.
Never in a million years. What if someone came into the room and found me talking to it? They'd think I was certifiable.
Please,
sir. Sarah, do not harp on this string. I'm too old a dog to learn new tricks. Get your book. I'm feeling surprisingly lucid this morning, and I think I can do a good letter. This is to Professor Shiko Furukawa, Stanford University. I'm returning herewith your manuscript, Insult and Injury. It's a very fine piece of work, and there is little to carp about it. You mentioned Colonel Bendetson. May I call your attention to his entry in the 48-49 edition of Who's Who. It states that Bendetson... Did you find it?
Yes.
Read it, please.
Colonel Bendetson conceived the method, formulated the details, and directed the evacuation of 125,000 persons of Japanese ancestry.
Good. Slip it in there. In the next edition of Who's Who, Bendetson had all references to the internment removed. Shortly thereafter, the American Civil Liberties Union called the internment the worst single wholesale violation of civil rights of American citizens in our history. New paragraph. As I expressed to you on the phone, any man who goes to his grave without regrets is a man who has failed to comprehend his life. My conscience reviews the internment almost daily, and daily I conclude that I failed miserably. My own deepest regret is that my vehement objections fell on deaf ears, and Henry Stimson, the Secretary of War, prevailed. Never again will I trust that mystic cliché, military necessity. New paragraph. I should forewarn you, since this is your first foray into publishing, that some of the critics will find insult and injury inordinately impassioned. You must, of course, ignore them. It is a given that this book could not have been born without your particular brain and without your particular brain, without your particular brain and your particular blood. Sincerely, etc. Type that up, please.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Dictaphone. This is Judge Biddle. I've come to right a wrong. That's why God created Democrats. Mr. Dictaphone, you've been rescued from the shelves at Ginn's, and now you are free to reside happily and gainfully here in my office. Sarah with an H, are you all right?
Yes, sir. I'll be out in a minute.
I'm sorry I was so intractable about the dictaphone. I promised to try it later this morning.
Thank you.
Best to dangle the hands a bit. Oh, dear, dear, dear. Symphony. Ballet. Opera. Theater. Always in need of money. Never understood it myself. Wrong-headed government priorities. Thought I might eventually if I lived long enough. Yeah, never will now. Who said it? Dos Passos? All we can learn about all who have gone before us We learn from the art they've left us. Something something tragic, somewhere in Dobson, I can't remember. Oh, where's the hell, where the hell's the Barclays? Something's amok. Probably just a female thing, the monthly female thing, yes. Henry Austin Dobson, used to know it by heart. Here it is, oh, scorched. I still smell the smoke. Dwat, gauche. Simple enough, but she couldn't get it through her thick skull. Ah, yes, here we are. All passes, art alone enduring stays to us, the busts outlast the throne. The coin, Tiberius. Yes. And Franklin remains on the dime. did you ever read the Maxims of Marcel Proust?
No, sir.
Proust says a wonderful thing about the endurance of art. Haven't looked at Proust in 50 years, so why I remember it is a mystery. Through all the centuries, Rembrandt and Vermeer continue to send us their special rays.
That's lovely. I'm so sorry.
Oh, goodness. Goodness me. Dear.
Forgive me. I'm sorry.
Please, no need to apologize. Was I hectoring again about the split infinitives?
No, sir, it's not that.
Is it the monthly female thing?
No, yeah, yes it is. It's the absence of it. I'm pregnant.
Oh. Well, I don't know what to say. I mean, there's so much one could say, but all of the things one usually says, well, I think they're not appropriate. When are you expecting?
July.
The fact is, I simply cannot engage the idea of a new life.
Yes, sir. I understand.
If I even contemplate all the ramifications of a birth, I'll be drawn into the morass.
I know, sir.
I cannot allow myself to be embroiled in, even to be on the periphery of your domestic difficulties.
No, should you, sir. I'm sorry, I'm really...
I have very little strength, and what I have is precious.
Yes, sir.
So I must ask you, please, Sarah, on my knees, Sarah, do not drag me into your problems.
No, sir, I won't. I'm all right. I'm all right now. Really, I am. May I get that?
I want you to understand that now... That it's not that I'm indifferent. It's that I'm in the process of leaving this life. The exit sign is flashing over the door, and the door is ajar.
Sir, I do understand it, but I'm very sorry for the awkward.
What I mean is discussion of these huge life issues exacts a toll, a psychic toll.
Yes, sir.
Please go ahead and type the letter. Sarah, come over here. You needn't bring your book. Sarah, it's the universal pattern. As if we're all on the same road on some obligatory map. We're born. We marry. We make our replacements. And then we die.
Yes, sir.
We have no say in the way we're born. And we have no say in the way we die.
Yes, sir.
And as we age, all we can do is wonder how it will happen. In a bed in your home, or a bed at the hospital, or at the dinner table, or jaywalking on Main Street. I'm sorry. Lately, no matter where I start, I wind up wondering how it's going to end. Sometime in the future, you want to write seriously.
Oh, yes, sir, I do.
You envision that as part of your journey.
Yes, sir.
Well, you mustn't think you can't pursue it because of the baby. You'll hire a nanny.
Oh, I don't know, sir. Where I come from, we raise our own children.
Well, then you'll just have to hold it in abeyance for a while. Abeyance is a woman's plight. Biology decided that, Betty Friedan notwithstanding. Is it possible for you to tell me what the problem is, briefly, in one sentence?
I am very, very lonely in my marriage.
You're both very young, and he's starting out. That might change.
I don't think it's likely.
Catherine and I lost a son in 1930. He was 7 years old.
Yes, sir.
Penicillin could have saved him.
Yes, sir. Life preservers, there were none.
I just don't have the resources for this. I just don't.
Sir, really, I do. I don't understand.
No, I don't think you can. You're at a disadvantage in that I have been young, but you've never been old. I have to call a friend at the justice. You'd best go finish the Fuhrer call letter.
Yes, sir. Sir, do you mean Melvin Granger at justice?
Yes, I need to call him.
Sir, are you sure?
Of course I'm sure. He resigned just before Christmas. I want to praise the job he's done and say goodbye.
Sir, you already did just before Christmas?
I couldn't have. I composed what I wanted to say over Christmas. Granger, justice.
Sir, you called and you quoted President Wilson. You said that when a man comes to Washington, he either swallows or he grows.
You're saying I have had that conversation?
Yes, sir.
You're positive?
Yes, sir.
The swells or grows conversation.
Yes, sir. You complimented Mr. Granger by saying that he grown and not swells.
All right, then, tell me, have I already written the man on 78th Street?
I'm sorry, sir, I don't know which man.
The Eleanor man, the man in New York City, he's got to be taken to task.
Oh, no, sir, you haven't. Let me find his letter.
I remember his letter.
Okay, sir, you're upset. I know what you're going to say, so why don't you let me write that letter and then we can sort through the mail.
And now, in addition to being a bugger for work, you're clairvoyant. You don't know what I'm going to say.
Oh, yes, I do. I know that what you're going to say is not about Mrs. Roosevelt.
Sarah, when you're in your persistent mode, the flies leave the room. I'm going to try the dictaphone, but I can't have your typing at the same time.
No, sir. I have bills to pay, and I can type later.
Nothing ventured, nothing gained. Faint heart ne'er won fair maiden, yes. So all I do is push the button and start.
That's all?
Does this make me a dictator? You'd best not answer that. Dear, what's his name in your letter of whenever it was? You say I brought the Eleanor Roosevelt manuscript to the editor-in-chief, and he was pleased. I'm sorry, but I'm compelled to correct you. You didn't bring the manuscript. You took the manuscript. Bring is used only when something is brought to you. The editor-in-chief might say, bring me the manuscript. You would take it to him, whereupon you would say, I took the manuscript to the editor-in-chief, and he would say, he brought the manuscript to me. New paragraph. This misuse of bring and take is common in New York City, and is a thorn in my side. And since everything that happens in New York City eventually emanates to the rest of the country, mostly, of course, from Madison Avenue, it is particularly dangerous to perpetuate this bastardization of our language. Sincerely, I leave it to you to plug in the niceties.
Yes, sir, I will.
Good luck, take heart, press on, all the best, etc., etc. I have to stretch out.
All right, sir.
Got a list of ailments from here to Mount Rushmore. If I fall asleep and noon creeps around, leave quietly and do not touch the heaters. If I fall asleep, perhaps you could type the Furukawa letter at home.
Oh, yes, sir. And, sir, if you'll trust me to sign the letter, I can take the manuscript to the post office before I come in the morning.
Are you suggesting that you'd forge my signature?
Oh, no. The custom is to sign it with my signature and then under it to write, as per Judge Biddle, Professor Furukawa would know that your secretary signed it with your permission.
That's just rude. It's not my custom, and you don't have my permission.
All right, sir, I'll bring it in and I'll go to the post office after you've signed it.
You're saving all the postal receipts, aren't you?
Yes, sir.
Deductible, you know.
Yes, sir.
Sarah.
Yes, sir.
I assume you've got good medical coverage, you know. For prenatal care and all that?
Thankfully, yes.
Good. Sarah. Mm.
Yes, sir.
There may be a solution to your situation, and there may not. But you must have this child and cherish it.
Yes, sir. I'm certainly going to try.
Thank God it's Friday.
You are not supposed to be here this early.
Madam, do not take that tone with me. You're not supposed to be this late.
Well, I'm sorry I stopped for a little chat with Mrs. Biddle. How about some coffee to warm you up?
How about not right now?
It's nice to see the tulips and daffodils up.
Oh, yes. Cook's got a big pot of crocus on the kitchen windowsill. Catherine and I were in Holland once at tulip time. Most astonishing display I've ever seen.
Oh, it must have been. Did Dr. Wellington actually come to the house?
Yep. House call. Four-star fish and loaves miracle. The nice thing about a house call is they don't leave you waiting on some table buck naked.
Well, what did he say?
Oh, cynical pass. As will lie if I told him. We were in London 2 years ago, at lilac time. Go down to Kew in lilac time, in lilac time, in lilac time.
Go down to Kew in lilac time, it isn't far from London.
All good Canadians know that.
Oh, all good Canadians worth their salt.
Did you have lilacs in Saskatoon?
Oh, yes, lilacs followed by peonies.
Come help me.
Well, no, sir, not till it's warmer in here.
Oh, very well, whatever you say. Tell me about spring on the prairie.
Well, you can't talk about spring on the prairie unless you talk about winter on the prairie. Full week of 40 below wasn't unusual.
That dry, piercing cold.
Glacial cold. Actually, Saskatoon is on the same latitude as Moscow, so spring is about one thing, the thaw. Saskatchewan River runs through Saskatoon, and in March, everyone in the city lays down bets as to when the ice will go out. They try to guess the exact day that the ice will break up, and the big 10-foot thick slabs will start to rumble and move and pile up against the bridges.
Sounds very dramatic.
Oh, yes, it is. In 1905, the ice took one of the bridges out with it. And then, almost immediately, all the backyard rinks melt, and the loons come back to the lakes, and the farmers ready the plows, and on the outskirts of the city, there's mile after mile of wild crocus. Not like Cook's potted purple ones, not domesticated, pale mauve and fuzzy and very perfumed. Yeah, yeah. We used to gather them up and carry them home in our dirndl skirts.
A far, far cry from Georgetown.
Oh, my, yes.
But indelible in the mind.
Indelible.
It's warm now. Come help me.
No, sir. I can feel the damp. Let me make one quick call.
But woe is me. You're a hard-hearted Hannah. And now I may say that you've taken control of my desk, you needn't relish the victory quite so much.
Oh, you're being paranoid.
You should see yourself. You look downright territorial.
Bosh and bunk.
Oh, you do. Seigneurial, as the French say. Like a feudal lord, or perhaps more appropriate to your ancestry, like a laird of the fiefdom.
Hello? Is this Mr. Joshua Crockett? This is Sarah Shore in Judge Biddle's office. Oh, you're welcome. Yes, I think I have the information you need. May I read it from my dictation? On your first question, they sailed for Nuremberg on the Queen Elizabeth. Judge Biddle said the ship was still shabby from carrying troops. On your second question about the American tribunal, Justice Robert Jackson, who had, of course, taken leave from the bench, and Judge Biddle, and their five assistants were housed together at number 2
Hebelstrasse.
Third question. Rudolf Hess attempted suicide twice. A commission of neurological experts reported that he was a psychopathic personality. Excuse me. Is that wrong?
No, but reporting that Hess was a psychopathic personality is rather like reporting that Hitler wasn't very well adjusted.
Judge Biddle says that the radio broadcasts were unquestionably treasonable. He said they indicted 11 of the worst of them and convicted 5. The 5 were Axis Sally, Tokyo Rose, Mr. Guess Who, Paul Revere, and Joe. They were all sent to prison. Mm-hmm. You're very welcome. I'll type this up and mail it to you. No, I'm sorry. He's unable to take calls today. Yes, I will. Thank you. Goodbye. He says to be sure to thank you.
Yeah. Did you see the cover of Life magazine?
Yes, Mrs. Taney and the children.
Yeah, Nixon, Humphrey, Kennedy, McCarthy. Whole kit and caboodle went to the funeral.
I didn't realize he was only 39.
Do you know any black people? I mean, anyone who would actually talk to you about the assassination?
No, I don't.
Neither do I. Therein lies the root of the problem. We don't live with them. We don't go to school with them. We don't work with them. One of their poets, Zora Neale Hurston, said, you can't know there till you go there.
Did you hear Bobby Kennedy's eulogy?
I did. Rather naive, to
to think that he could quell their rage by saying that a white man assassinated his brother. Catherine met Zora once, some kind of poetry salon. New York City, 1928, I think.
Wait a minute. I wish you would just wait for me.
No, I'm always waiting for you. I start the damn day waiting for you. And if you take that tone with me one more time, you're going to find yourself smack back at the employment agency.
Yes.
Oh, God, no, must we?
We must.
But I hate the damn smell.
But you love the relief.
Just as Granny did.
Just as Granny did.
More bad news about great-nephew Michael. Word has it that he got on a Greyhound bus, and he's crashing somewhere near San Francisco.
Probably Hite Ashbury.
The first sentence on the Rosetta Stone, 2nd century B.C., is, "What is the matter with the next generation?" There was an unusually warm, sunny day last week.
Who's that?
Maybe. Can't remember. Don't know anymore. Anyway, I went out for an afternoon walk. Just a short one, you know. Around 30th and P. And I had a sort of a prescient moment about my mortality.
Your mortality?
Yes.
If this is going to be a dirge, I really don't want to hear it.
I don't think it is. I knew that I wouldn't die out there, but somehow I knew that it would be my last afternoon walk. So I looked down at the sidewalk, and I realized it was time to say goodbye.
Oh, surely not to the sidewalk.
No. To my shadow. You dare.
No. You know, sir, I won't. I'll just go and wash my hands.
If I hear anything resembling tears, I will rise like a phoenix and go right through this ceiling.
All you will hear is the water running.
I'm awfully glad you're done with your morning upchuck.
Oh, so am I. Oh, please don't talk to me while the water's running because I won't be able to hear you.
Are you feeling anything yet?
Yes. Last week a couple.
Huh. Oh, Sarah.
Yes?
I want to add something to the Groton section.
Well, wait a minute.
All I do is wait.
What did you say?
I want to add something to the Groton section. I can't bear the dictaphone today. Get your book.
I think the Groton section is fascinating.
Do you mean that? Or are you apple polishing?
Sir, I don't apple polish.
No, you don't. Quality is sometimes a blessing and sometimes a curse.
Where will this be placed?
Somewhere around the little blue suits with the Eton collars. We were forbidden on Sunday to do anything but write our parents. Our parents.
Would you like to do this later?
No. I want to do it now. We were forbidden on Sunday to do anything but write our parents. No skating on the pond, no sports, certainly no cards. And there was terrific, brutal punishment from the upper forms if you stepped out of line. The Reverend Endicott Peabody reminded us, ad nauseum, that his strength is as the strength of 10 because his heart is pure. But I had no strength at all. And the impurest of parts, all of this manifested by a photograph hidden deeply in my dresser drawer. Photograph of a pinup. Surely one of the first pinups ever. A photo of a naughty, gorgeous girl.
That last bit ran on terribly. Will you fix it?
Yes, I will.
Her name was Evelyn Nesbitt. She was my secret for a brief interval. But by the time I graduated, she was known on Broadway as the girl in the red velvet swing. Slip it in there appropriately, will you?
Yes, Mrs. Biddle. No, ma'am, not yet. Yes, I will very soon. Understandably. Oh, you're welcome.
Catherine?
Yes.
What did she want?
Sir, I have to talk to you about something.
Oh, heavens, look at the brow. Furrowed with the weight of the world.
Well, sir, Mrs. Biddle called me at home last night and asked me to come in early today for a meeting. She feels... Well, and I agree that this should be your last week here in the office. Well, when you get here, you're no longer able to go to your desk. So it makes no sense to have you struggling across the yard and climbing the stairs just to lie on the cot. We'll take the dictaphone to the house, and then, if you find that you need to urgently dictate...
Need to dictate urgently.
If you need to dictate urgently, you can do it there. Then I will bring the dictaphone here and do the transcription and bring the letters to the house for signature. I'll continue to work here, and if you need anything, all you'll have to do is buzz me on the phone.
You'd think a spouse of 50 years would not have to delegate this matter.
Sir, she has alluded to it many times, and you wouldn't discuss it. And she was afraid of a tune-up. Mrs. Biddle is rather frail herself these days. She asked my opinion, and I...
Do you mind? Please go and get my vitae. I want it to be accurate for the press. Do you know where it is?
Yes, I've seen the file passing.
The secretary who typed it is the same damn one that started the fire. The woman's ineptitude was catastrophic.
Oh, I know, sir, but isn't that a surprising contradiction?
What do you mean?
That she was such a catastrophe, even though the shorthand was Greg.
Madam, you are bold.
Sorry.
You are not discreet. Read it to me.
AB, Harvard University, 1909, L.
Cum laude.
Cum laude. LLB, Harvard Law School, 1911, person...
Cum laude.
Cum laude. Personal Secretary, Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes, Supreme Court, 1911 to 1912.
Let's get to the heart of the matter. Take this down, please. Biddle was born and raised a Republican. It was during the Great Depression in the 1930s that he became acutely aware of the plight of the Pennsylvania coal miners. That is when he became a Democrat. That is when I began to understand the real cost, the exorbitant cost, the inexcusable cost of ignoring poverty in our midst. What's she got for 1940?
Solicitor General, 1940, Attorney General, 1941 to 45, Chief American Judge of the International Military Tribunal, Nuremberg Trials, 1945-46. Chairman, Americans for a Democrat Action, 1950-53.
And through it all, every juncture, At every juncture, I had a running dialogue with my absent father. What precisely did I say at the beginning of the Groton edition?
We were forbidden on Sunday to do anything but write our parents. No skating on...
I didn't have parents. My father died when I was 6 years old.
Do you want me to include this?
No, I don't. I don't want to have a lot of maudlin blubbering on the printed page. I barely remember him. His death was like some vile poison I had to take, some noxious poison that once swallowed would never leave my system. I think I'd like to go to the house now.
Now, sir? It's only...
Please get my things. I have very little strength. What I have is precious.
did your mother remarry?
No. With four boys, she appeared to be occupied, but mostly she waited to die. I showed you her picture, didn't I?
No, sir.
In my desk, second drawer on the right. And then, of course, in 1930, Catherine and I lost a son. When people who would have loved you fall out of your life, it's an indescribable sorrow, a kind of nameless pain, and nowhere in the world is there a privilege or a promotion or a prize that can fill the void. She was beautiful, wasn't she?
Yes, she has lovely eyes.
That was before she was widowed. One's eyes are what one is. One's mouth, what one becomes. John Galsworthy. Yes. I'll take it to the house. Deterioration, debilitation, death. What an absurd plan. Isn't it strange? I've never been a slow learner, but I've only recently fully realized that when we're born, we're just visiting the world a little.
Sir? Do you want me to help you down?
No. I'll hold the rein. Go perch yourself at my desk and open the mail. Chatelaine of a new domain.
All right.
Master of all you survey. Colossus bestriding the narrow world. Do you have a favorite title?
I'm sorry, I don't understand.
A book title. Of all the books you've read, do you have a favorite title?
Well, I like Edmund Wilson's Axel's Castle. I like the way it sort of gnashes itself at you. And there's a Canadian novel called By Grand Central Station, I Sat Down and Wept. I've always liked that. What's your favorite title?
It's from Vita Sackville West. You know, Virginia Woolf's intimate friend. Not a great book, but a great title. All Passion Spent. My mother said that people were attracted to my dad. She said he had a large circle of friends. Apparently, he often had lunch with old Mrs. Gillespie, Benjamin Franklin's great-granddaughter. Have a good weekend.
Thank you.
I'll see you on Monday at the house.
Yes, sir. Categories. Personal papers for Georgetown University, family papers for the University of Pennsylvania, and Nuremberg papers for Syracuse. Oh, I'm sorry, that's the other line. Goodbye. Hello? May I ask who's calling? No, Mrs. Biddle isn't taking any calls today. I'm Judge Biddle's secretary, Sarah Shore. Perhaps I could help you? Yes, Sarah with an H. Yes, the funeral was private, but there will be a memorial service at the National Cathedral at a date to be announced. No. No, he wasn't at home. He was at the hospital. Oh, you're welcome. Checked yet. Do you think there's anything on it? Oh, he did. To whom? Would that be his great nephew? Okay, I'll check right away. Mm-hmm. I'll let you know.